This is Babette Babich, and I teach philosophy at Fordham University. My specialization is on the work of Friedrich Nietzsche. In particular, I pay attention to his investigations into ancient Greek rhythm and meter, his interest in music, his interest in tragedy, and I've also myself written on music and philosophy with regard to Socrates, with regard to Heidegger, and of course Nietzsche, and Adorno, and in another context, postmodern musicology. Today, I'm going to be talking about a text that's related to all of that, The Birth of Katie Lang's Hallelujah, Performance Practice, and the Spirit of Music. Musicological musing and philological philosophy on Katie Lang. I begin here with a discussion of what musicologists would call Katie Lang's performance practice in terms of what Nietzsche similarly technically named the spirit of music in her interpretations of Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah. In the second half, I will use this reflection in order to raise the question of what Nietzsche called the problem of the artist. The focus is on Katie Lang, not as composer, although she is one, but musical performer, and not as guitarist, although she is one, but as a singer. And although her live performances have to make all the difference, very specifically for the sake of any analysis, it's also the case that much of her singing is available in video format, and I'm going to be talking about a particular video. Of course, there are many readings of Katie Lang in popular music, and of course, most of them focus on the way she dresses. Others look at her sexuality. And here, just for a bit, I consider her musicality. And I'm going to call that the Hallelujah effect on the internet, Facebook contexts, and YouTube poker. I first heard Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah, rather improbably, given the sheer number of recording artists who have interpreted his song, as sung by Cohen himself. Not in person, of course, but, and this will be the point and the heart of what follows, on the radio. How old-fashioned. That is to say, as a recording. Although I liked it, it had no particular effect on me, although I am an admirer of Cohen's approach in theory, and I am fond of the genre of word jazz. Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah clearly captivates singers, but being not too much of a fan, I never thought much about it. I could, as we say, take it or leave it. That was until what I call dueling video posts on Facebook. Now, the thing about Facebook is the chance to pretend to be in contact with people with whom one is no longer in actual contact. Friends from one's youth, colleagues from various past acquaintances, and in what is perhaps the largest category of Facebook friends, that would also be people one has never met, but whom one supposes one ought to have met or whom one would like to meet, or just because. This would be the California or whatever kind of friend, as well as family members and such. Facebook achieves this, as its name suggests, by including pictures of the same, along with the aforementioned video posts, most of which are borrowed from YouTube, and because this is a virtual rather than a real book, also by a wall, like nothing so much as a public bathroom wall. One is often alone when writing on said wall, on one's own wall or those of others, and one writes precisely with the expectation that others simply passing through or vaguely loitering, finally a meaning for that phrase, will chance to read it. And like such scribblings, Facebook posts often have a kind of high or distant humor, provocative or conceived, just to get a rise out of people. It's not for nothing that Facebook has an odd category of the poke, which I have never used, but propose to understand as of a piece with this character of provocative instigation. And this matters for the Facebook video post. Facebook denizens craft their posts to ensure a response, and even if they do not admit this, it's clear that they are frustrated if this is not successful. For my own part, I post mostly informative, i.e. didactic posts, and friends, so I believe, counter or filter these by simply tuning them out. Thus, the experience of Facebook tends to be rather more than less autistic, and in a wired age, this autism may be its most subversive quality. Nevertheless, And when the within the safe space of friendly faces and sympathetic voices and modulated in accord with what Derrida once called a higher tone, that is, language elevated to a public level and therefore raised to a higher, more gracious and occasionally ironic tone, there are also inspiring occasions. Thus, when Claire Katz, my friend and philosophical colleague at Texas A&M, posted the Shrek Hallelujah, expressing enthusiasm for the same, I was moved to a bit of what I call YouTube poker, an exchange very common on Facebook. Thus, I saw her Rufus Wainwright post and raised it by a Katie Lang. Not any Katie version either, but her live 2005 Juno version, which I found among many other singers in several other versions. And Andrew Benjamin, it mattered to me that this came from Australia, returned with an absolute hands-down yay-saying. Now, and this is also a peculiar advantage of Facebook, it is significant that Andrew is a practical aesthetics person. Architectural theory, philosophy, and so on are his thing. Thus, sheerly theoretically, Andrew's comment brought me to think on what had moved me to join the poker game in the first place, and indeed to what that seemingly idle gesture had brought me. Now, this may sound as if I am cooler than your average professor or Nietzsche scholar, as if I, like Andrew, know my Katie Lang. But looking for Leonard Cohen, which is to say, and this is what I mean about didacticism, looking for the original conventionally understood, I had found this version instead and instantly added a link. In fact, I fell off the floor in response to the song I heard, which was indeed the song, the YouTube post I saw. The piano, almost enough for the absolutist, musically speaking, in me, had taken me from the start, but Katie Lang's poise was also a living embodiment of the song as well. Indeed, everything was dynamic poise, possession, lived expression. Now, the camera person who filmed the live Juno 2005 performance had a lot, perhaps everything, to do with it. This is the point of a video. This is movie magic. Thus, although I usually emphasize, as I've already stated, the difference, the key difference it makes to be physically, that is, really present in performance, in person, in real space, just in order to speak about music at all and to begin with, there can be no doubt that most of us today experience music in the hardwired way, often with earbuds, recorded, often digital music. But the digital character of today's music, and I encourage the listener to search out the reference in the video, the text of this text, because that footnote includes a world to unpack in this digital character. That would be the engineering of sound. I refer to Dyson's "When Is the Ear Pierced?" The whole, in this case, question of the digital is one world, one thing. The whole package of the YouTube experience, like the closed world of Facebook, is another. Here it is the full production, theatrical light set of the Juno performance that turns out to be important, if and initially subliminally so. For Katie Lang's performance is set against the crucial backdrop of a light show, a shifting and subtle series of slides, blue light cutouts and religious frames, stained glass, including a blue rose window, crosses and high Gothic rectangles of light. And as she sings, and imperceptibly, the framed illuminations change with the music. Piano, contrabass, single guitar, thus comprising what one might call an orchestra band, all cellos and strings, including a conductor, the setting clearly delineated from verse to verse, chorus to chorus, shifting from religious forms to a blue starry night expanse at the climax. Nor does it turn out to be any kind of accident that Lang speaks of the cinematic quality of Cohen's Hallelujah as making the song for her, she's always careful to qualify this, an easy one. Then, too, there is the age-old question of content and musical style, important for Nietzsche, who always wondered about the fate of music where the words themselves demanded to be understood. This would be in the context of European opera. Well, at the same time, this is Nietzsche's schizophrenia, emphasizing that when it came to antiquity, the ancient Greeks went to the theater to hear beautiful speech, the beauty of the spoken word, whereas he recalls for us there would be no difference in antiquity between speech and song. It's for this reason that I found myself led to pose the question of Katie Lang's performance practice, seeking thereby a better understanding of what Nietzsche had called the spirit of music. That spirit is very literally, very exactly sounded in the case of the Greeks' own voicing of their own language, especially poetically, because as Nietzsche had discovered, and it's a real philological discovery, one could not perform the tragedies without singing them. Not ever, and not because he argued for missing musical scores, and not because of the lyre or cithara accompaniment, but, kithara some say, but and because and again, to speak was to sing. With Katie Lang, what struck me was the lyrics themselves. And note that because Leonard Cohen doesn't sing, it's not exactly as if it's difficult to understand the words. His is not that kind of music. With Lang singing, the words sung began, and for the first time to make all the difference. When I heard Cohen himself, I found myself seeing through his poem. Its artifice, or call it artfulness. For me, the words were short on their own religious content or context and not at all advanced by a calculatedly vulgar, overtly and self-consciously masculine. I should ask myself if it mattered that Cohen's Toronto compositions would be written in the wake of the enormous success of Serge Gainsborough's Je vais, je viens, in his breathlessly sung with Jane Birkin, Je t'aime, moi non plus. That is, self-indulgence, quoi eroticism. This did not mean that I could not acknowledge that this would be, for many, the theological heart of the song itself. It would seem that there's nothing like mentioning the Holy Dove, where the Church itself has banned talk of the ghost in favor of the spirit, and doing so in the same context that inspired Gainsborough. Katie Lang's version offers an entire world, cinematic, as she says, but one that, as she walks into that world, opens the meaning of the song, the verses, each word. Now, the problem here is that I'm not a lesbian, and it's not that I've always wanted to be a lesbian. I am one of those rare, and they really are rare, women who actually like men. Not personally, as if men were always great, that is, as men are in the world, in their ways, and in terms of their character, as this way of being is often not so very nice at all, especially when it comes to the way they treat the woman in their lives, from their mothers to the woman they love. But in much rather, and very exactly, in terms of their bodies. Their bodies themselves, the male body as such. Thus I like men the way, fairly as I would suppose, and there are obvious limitations to this claim, that a homosexual man might say that he likes men, that is, aesthetically speaking, and it is for the sake of the latter that, for most of my life, I have put up with the men I have loved. I mourn the loss of the first boy I ever loved, all because of his lost beauty. He died young, everything inconsummate, pure potential, unsullied and unsullyable perfection, all John Keats' destiny and undying power for my soul. Conversely, personally, I am not an admirer of female beauty, as both men and women and Katie Lang love female beauty, but, and much rather, male beauty, face, body, every erotic aspect. And in fact, and in real life, for me, even for me, beauty alone still falls short when it comes to love affairs. And I remember wishing that one particularly beautiful lover would simply not speak, so unbearably boring was he. This was never said, but it surely sped the end of the relationship. Relating to men in this fashion, that is, as an admirer of male beauty, and if one is interested, as I was always interested in erotic encounters, is difficult, I would say, impossible. I echo Lacan. Speaking as a woman desiring men, with respect to men, there is no sexual relation there. None at all, no possibility, not a chance. Which is hardly to say, and it would be false and silly to say, that it's difficult to find an opportunity to sleep with men. The point to be made is that men are not about being desired for their beauty as such, and if it comes to light that they are so desired, it unmans them, literally so, and there is nothing erotic in that. Men as the ruling gender, and which gender did you think had hegemony in this world, are, when it comes to erotic encounters, exceedingly advanced at having those encounters only and precisely on the very specific terms they themselves set. Hence, there is an erotic object in every heterosexual erotic encounter, and the guys themselves are not that object. Of course, I'm not saying that women do not and in general enjoy the beauty of their lovers' bodies in all possible ways, and I'm also sure that this varies from person to person. But women are inevitably limited in bringing this out in any but the most oblique ways. And as I say this, I realize that people watching this, men watching this, women watching this, will protest that this doesn't apply to them. I simply beg to differ. If it is women who are the objects of desire, for heterosexual women, but not less for women, both heterosexual and homosexual, such that, save in the case of lesbian desire, which is why many women find it so fascinating, the desire of the heterosexual woman is, as Nietzsche put it, rather more flatly than Hegel, to be desired rather than to desire. Hegel uses different words, but Nietzsche, for his part, the language of will or command. Hegel focuses on desire, Nietzsche less so. Then, and by contrast with the desire to be desired, men are subjects all the way down. It's not that they don't desire to be desired, it's that they take that as a given, and thus need not and do not desire it. If they're not desired, there's something wrong with the woman. Hence, even the word beauty, as applied to men, already bothers them, and just because it objectifies them. Even the so-called metrosexual trend works only because it bounces off, glances off, men dressing, not for men, pardon me, not for women, I'm misspeaking here, but for men. And heterosexual men do that too. GQ, corporate style, the sky's the limit. But only, and this is the key, for one another. Perhaps the reader has heard of Savile Row, Hong Kong tailoring, and so on. You don't really care for music, do you? That'll be the next section. Indeed, and during the heyday of the sexual revolution, which also for good measure included women's liberation, if we may speak of that failed undertaking in that way, when it was popularly protested then that women ought not perhaps be regarded as sex objects, this was a protest, men were fond of countering with the assertion that they would love to be sex objects. And they claimed this not because it was true, but because they were keen on what they called free love, or sex without strings. And, to go back to our Katie Lang, S&M, until her singing of Cohen's Hallelujah, was not part of what Cohen's reference to the real anxiety, the unmanning threat consequent to being tied to a kitchen chair, as in the circumstance that that was for Samson himself. In fact, that is, in practice or real life, men do not like women who come on to them. Ladies at the bar, please take note. And women know this, and this is why they dress and act and walk the way they do. But even suborned as objects to the subject who gets to desire in the first place, women do not get close to loving men for their beauty unless arranged in such a way that men do not notice. Just take care not to give yourself away. At best, one might adjust a tie, choose a shirt, mend a shaving scar, etc. But woman as such remains the sexual, the erotic object for both heterosexual men as for both heterosexual and lesbian women. And that's important to note for the title of The Second Sex. De Beauvoir titled The Second Sex that way because Simone de Beauvoir wanted to emphasize that if one says sex, just sex itself, the sex, one is, in France and in the early 20th century erotic literature of the day, that would be 20th century literary porn, sex referred to woman. And one can try to change that if one wants to see if men can be the object, stage some kind of performance-inspired drama. But it won't be a full-on erotic encounter. Not really. Not at all. Although it is the erotic encounter that matters here, it is music that is in question in Cohen's song. You don't really care for music, do you? Set up by the inside talk of a secret chord that David had, and it pleased the Lord. It was, I have said, Lang's rendering of Cohen's exposed illustration of the verse. It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, that caught me. utterly, and I needed to see her do it for it to have the effect that it did. Not only acoustic, but visual. Not only visual, but dramatic. And add to that the resonance of the words with life, the body, God, and time, the intellect, and sex. A minor riff on the 19th century ideal of the Gesamtkunstwerk. Is Katie Lang's version different from other versions? How so? How does she do what she does? Indeed, how does she manage to do it again and again? Though professional singers, one must say, do this all the time. C'est son métier, quand même. It's their job. But this is also why they lip-sync their songs from time to time, singing backup, as it were, with themselves. I've already noted that part of Katie Lang's appeal apparently derives for her following from what some call her cross-dressing. For my part, I find her clothes unremarkable, and I have never understood why only a man might be permitted to wear a comfortable jacket covering most of his body with decent tailoring, bespoke, and be thought to look well-dressed, but women were seemingly required to uncover theirs. This exactly double standard holds when it comes to song and dance shows. Think Ginger Rogers and Fred Astaire, and only Gene Kelly, or more recently the late Patrick Swayze, and both had good muscular reasons to do so, take a care to opt for form-fitting dance clothes. I will not mention Dean Martin or Kitty Lang's Tony Bennett because they, of course, exemplify the point. The form-fitting clothes rule is hard on middle-aged women singers. And these days, and for some time now, Madonna has struggled to match the bodies of her more youthful competitors. And then, too, there's the always debated issue of damaging one's voice by starving oneself. But Katie Lang's own sexuality made the difference here. Perhaps it made all the difference. And to illustrate this, we note that if the venue, or their label, permitted other singers who have covered Cohen's song to take the risk of offending so-called family values, no one wonders how families innocent of sex became families in the first place, just to echo Nietzsche's complaint about Wagner's Parsifal, these same other male singers didn't fail to repeat Cohen's weaker style Gainsborough lyrics, although Gainsborough himself couldn't have been more sexually heterosexually overt if he had tried, where Cohen writes a very crucial verse. This is the one male singers cannot wait to get to, perhaps because men tend to blame their partners for what changes in love between them, perhaps because it is the most explicit. There was a time you let me know what's really going on below. But now you never show it to me, do you? And remember, when I moved in you, the holy dove was moving too, and every breath we drew was hallelujah. Lang cuts this utterly. But what's astonishing is that, and at the same time, she keeps every bit of erotic tension on hand and from the start, with Cohen's reference to David and Bathsheba, that's 2 Samuel 11. You saw her bathing on the roof. Her beauty and the moonlight overthrew you, which some male singers like Buckley, to continue the above subject's point of view, opt to sing as her beauty in the moonlight. Lang keeps the conjunction clear, and her phrasing separates it. This is the whole of Eros already in place. Overcome, overwhelmed, we are talking about the way Eros works on us, from without, ready or not. It comes upon us, and this is desire. By keeping this on the level of desire, we are also able, this is the mystery that is also already present from the start, to find that we are talking about God. And Lang does this without Cohen's emphases, that previous verse, the holy dove. But now you never show it to me, do you? And remember, when I moved in you, the holy dove was moving too. Thus, and in the middle of another YouTube post, including a number of other songs, Katie Lang, preternaturally conscious, this makes her both a very good and a very bad subject for television interviews, says, "Welcome to Church," a double joke at a concert in a church to introduce a set of songs, including a rendition of Hallelujah. As a songwriter, Cohen's own words work as poetry, and it matters in this that Cohen gives us throughout rhymes to hear. The incipit, "I heard there was a secret chord," and the second line, "that David sang and it pleased the Lord," takes us in. The rhyme between heard, chord, Lord, secured with an echoing assonance between heard there. These are the mystery cults, the rites, the esoteric circles of both religion and music, and it pleased the Lord. This chord, this secret, accords with those same rites this chord pleases, which should very well entail that this chord would, if only one knew it, but it's a secret, work for us too. If only we might learn it. We're taken in, we're captivated, and it would seem that this is precisely what the songwriter wishes of us, as he promotes himself, not hesitating, I quote here, to advertise his technique. The words are from a musicologist friend of mine, Ernest MacLean. Advertise. Indeed, MacLean's musicological analyses, just an informal one, just in personal email correspondence, confirms what Cohen says when he tells us, this telling us so would be the postmodern move, that he is telling us what he's doing. It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, and it's exactly here that I am undone, for this is also the way Lang sings it. Now one might be inclined to say that, sure, everyone sings it this way. Cohen sings it this way. Wainwright and Buckley and any number of singers sing it this way. Four Norwegian tenors sing it this way in around trading verses. Yes, and again, no. Everyone does not sing it this way because Lang, and this is key, sings the song itself, and her gestures are crucial. She builds and moves into the song. Thus, in the YouTube video of the live performance that I'm talking about here, a performance which, qua YouTube video, is not live, which is why we can analyze it, it is as if she were directing herself, directing the song itself, directing her own verse, her own chorus. Thus, she plays with open fingers, the fourth, the fifth, and with a downturned hand smoothly traces the minor fall, recovering with an upturned hand the major lift, and powerfully a baffled king composing Hallelujah. Because, and then, there is the walking, beginning by standing by the piano in contemplative reflection poised in time, that is the time of the singer's musical silence, the time of the piano introduction, Katie Lang begins by singing and walks into and through the song, and it seems as if the song takes her through the whole of time and space. Musical time, musical space. Well, your faith was strong, but you needed proof. And here it helps to be either Leonard Cohen singing of David and Bathsheba or Katie Lang singing exactly the same lines with the same sympathy. You saw her bathing on the roof, her beauty and the moonlight overthrew you. Again, as Lang sings it, every word, every sentiment comes clear. The dissonance that follows, mixing David and Samson and every man-child. Well, she tied you to a kitchen chair. She broke your throne and cut your hair. The whole of trauma is here. This is what shatters a lifetime. It is this pent up and waiting that brings down a temple. It will be Lang's gestures. It will be her eyes, the turn of her head to speak of the moonlight and its rapture, winding the cord of her microphone to illustrate being tied to the kitchen chair, but also looking straight at the audience as she does so, that make it plain that this is a sexual come on. She, of course, it was she who did this, broke your throne, and cutting with her fingers to illustrate, and cut your hair. Here, after all this, is nothing more than the space of the musical phrase. And the listener knows this gets under your skin, that the one addressed is you yourself, a different you, some other you, son of man. And from your lips she drew, and here are disputes between the need to add an article, Wainwright and most men name it, determine it, the Hallelujah. What is it? What would it be to, as Nietzsche says, praise the demon who speaks thus? What kind of belief do you have? What kind of abased, abashedly awful love do you have to still say, as Abraham, Job, David, your faith was strong, but you needed proof. Hallelujah. Anyone who has felt it all, and what is the reference here? It is to you and to the appeal of the senses, sensuality, her beauty in the moonlight. On the matter of affirmation, Nietzsche reflects that if there's just one thing to which you would say yes, then you also and inevitably affirm every other thing, because everything is inextricably intertwined, interknotted, tied, broken, cut. And from your lips she drew, what, a groan of ecstasy, suffering? Hallelujah. The four hallelujahs that follow are small miracles of understatement and perfectly articulated power, one after another. If the composer's confidence is that he can tell us what he is doing with his chord, the composer's singer brings it home and brings us back to the present as she does so, referring to the song itself, sung as the singer sings it. Baby, I've been here before. I've seen this room and I've walked the floor. Eroticized, consummately so, in the Juno performance where Katie Lang cocks her head and puts her hand on her hip, the classic instantiation of Eros. I need you. I don't need you. I used to live alone before I knew you. Doing this, exerting distance, one is brought to the extraordinary pathos of Cohen's song. But I've seen your flag on the marble arch. And this is KD. This pathos, she, as I say, takes home this point of desolation, abasement, sorrow, wounding, reproof. Our love is not a victory march. It's a cold and it's a broken hallelujah. This is all we're given, all we have. This is all there is. It is a deity, in this case, whose only redemption, whose only blessing for us, whose only grace is emptiness, indigence, frailty. This is also what Nietzsche named the becoming human of dissonance. This is what I once elsewhere, in a reflection on Eros love, called coolly and mightily wrong. Not the redemption of love. Not the saving love, the kind that works out in the end, the love that ends well, finding glory and secure joy, but a shattered love, wrong from the start all the way down, a cold and broken hallelujah. Cascade, crescendo, hallelujahs in chorus ascending again and again. Maybe there's a God above. Maybe indeed, but this God is already close enough to the Jewish and close enough to the Christian that Cohen, like Nietzsche, turns to reflect on what it might mean to be a God at all and to be implicated in love. Here, and this is the Liberty Valence moment, as Katie plays it perfectly, all mimesis given away. All I've ever learned from love, she confesses, is how to shoot somebody who outdrew you. Shaking her head, we know that this is no achievement, that this shows nothing but the abjection, the inadequacy of love, what we are moved to do, and what we ultimately do anyway. And this is brought all the way to the top, to what it is to love God, to praise God, pleasing, displeasing, and the vast distance between what that is and what we commonly take it to be. It's not a cry you hear at night. It's not someone who's seen the light. It's a cold and broken hallelujah. And it is what Lang does with the hallelujahs to follow, punctuated and powerfully sung, and in contrast with the visceral as she crouches into the pain of these hallelujahs, finally, unutterably, impossibly sustained, eyes closed, an extraordinary peace out from the center of being, her being, to open and raise her eyes and our thoughts. Consummate breath. The song affects everyone who hears it, even those, I think, who don't like it. And because Katie Lang's great secret is that she listens to the space around her, even to the extent of feeling it. She does this in 2010 at her live performance at the Olympic Winter Games in Vancouver. But this listening also means that she's affected as well. And in 2005, the smile she gives the audience in response to their response after the song is a striking contrast to the composed professionalism of the song in its pace and delivery. Indeed, when Katie Lang sings this, to Leonard Cohen's own approbation on the occasion of his 2006 induction into the Canadian Songwriters Hall of Fame, she knows at every instant exactly where she is and in whose presence she sings. And she also knows whose song it is, giving utter and moving homage to Cohen, running down from the stage to greet him as suppliant, touching her head to his solar plexus, all deference, concession, gratitude. On the hallelujah technique, postscript. Every bit of what I have just described is deliberate, controlled, contrived, packaged, performed. To say this takes no part of the achievement away from either Katie Lang or Leonard Cohen. We are watching a consummate artist at work. And as Nietzsche said, speaking of Wagner, we might do well to ignore issues of technique, questions concerning the conditions, motivations, practices of the artist, where, as Nietzsche supposed, what matters is the work, the working of the work of art on us as music. Nietzsche himself suggests that he would be both drawn in by and made anxious at the same time by what he, in The Gay Science, described as, this is the title of the aphorism, woman who master the masters. As Nietzsche reflects, and his observation touches on the voice quite apart from gender and apart from music, but not apart from the stage, a deep and powerful alto voice of the kind one sometimes hears in the theater can suddenly raise the curtain upon possibilities in which we usually do not believe. All at once, we believe that somewhere in the world there could be women with lofty, heroic, and royal souls, capable of and ready for rule over men, because in them the best elements of man, apart from his sex, have become an incarnate ideal. The problem for Nietzsche is that this ideality is usually then read back into men, and that the entire project still falls short of what real human beings do, or better said, what they do not do. If Nietzsche had learned one thing from Goethe's Faust, it was to see through love and its vanities. But where Nietzsche challenged that the theatrical bet placed on the efficacy of such voices, female, or as he pointed out in his text, mostly male, as in, I quote here, and we can think of Rudolph Valentino, the ideal male lovers, such as Romeo, tended not to succeed. MacLean, my musicological friend, reminds us that Cohen's achievement is real, a working one, a practiced one, attuned to musical efficacy for us today. Thus, when I asked about the chord in question, about what secret might be manned, MacLean explained that there is no secret at all. Everything is overt, announced. The song elaborates, we can then add, a musical joke, a tease. The jest in the words is exactly what they describe. So MacLean writes, to me, about Cohen, he mainly oscillates on the mild colors of major tonic and relative minor, with two tones in common, as I described. His first very strong progression, these are all in quotes with MacLean, is a truncated cadence. You don't really care for music, do you? Meaning movement, a whole tone upward from subdominant to dominant. But he's late getting to the latter and throws it away on the tonic, do you? For MacLean, all this is calculated artistry, not only brilliantly plain, but consummately effective, and that is to say, on musical terms. It's Cohen's song that allows Katie Lang to do what she does. And this is also why it's quite believable, whether true or not, I don't know, that Cohen wrote some 80 verses to it. What's certain is that where he accepted his induction in 2006, after listening to Katie Lang's performance, Cohen was moved to reclaim, that is, to recite just one more verse. But this too is the heart of Cohen's Hallelujah, as MacLean analyzes it, and I quote MacLean again, after the third verse, Cohen extends these responses by six measures, and after the last, he writes an extended coda of two measures, longer than his song of only 26. And I'll end that quote. In this way, Cohen loses not a thing by telling us what he does, in a never mind, why not be, postmodern kind of way. And MacLean writes to me, the composer is whimsically describing his effort by embodying it. And he puts these in caps in his email, as people imagine that screaming. But I don't think it is, it's just in caps. And he hasn't anything more to say. The alleluias that follow are anything but, and he goes back to lowercase in the email, it doesn't matter who says them. They're ironic nothings where you might expect a real answer from the chorus. This is a burst bubble. Subsequent verses introduce slight rhythmic variations that are not really motivic, but inspired by his melody, which needs the words pronounced with proper stress. This man's bubble bursts four times in a row, four strophic verses to the same melody and harmony, and all the alleluias are sour grapes, milking the audience for sympathy that it gladly gives. Ooh, there's a lot said here. And I leave the claims that MacLean makes to one side for the moment to note the audience's sympathy here. And this is common for popular music as a kind of singing with or what I have elsewhere, and this may be what drew me to this analysis, called consinity. That's a musical term that means a singing with. You've got to sing with Nietzsche's text just to be able to read it in the specific context of Nietzsche's philosophical style and with regard to his epistemology. This next section turns a little bit more to Nietzsche's technicality between performance practice and the becoming human of dissonance. Nietzsche's own philological and phenomenological investigations of the spirit of music in antiquity began with his explorations of the musical character of the Greek language as spoken, sung, beginning with his reflections on Greek music drama and dance, all replete with little illustrations. Arsis, thesis. Nietzsche's exploration turns out to be all about dance, drama, but above all about the literal music of the poem itself, which phenomenological hermeneutic in turn was dependent upon Nietzsche's discovery of the musical resonances of ancient Greek. And because Katie Lang walks the music as she does, it struck me that we might learn something, hear something, guess at something, for, as Nietzsche always also reminds us, we need to guess where we do not and cannot know. What might this tell us about the chorus, about its movement in ancient Greek tragedy, about the tragedian, qua lyric artist, as Nietzsche posed this question, but also and indeed in terms of the song itself? Nietzsche argued that the artistic role of his own science, that would be classical philology, classics, as science, as a scholarly technique, corresponded neither to that of the artist nor that of the composer, but and much rather to the performer. The scholar's work would amount to a virtual making present, the long German word, a Vergegenwärtigung, of the kind one can perform by articulating, that is, speaking, singing, sight-reading ancient Greek within the constraints, that's also to say, the chains of rhythm and time, that is to say, out of the spirit of music. One of Nietzsche's more powerful examples, one of his most powerful images, is the idea of dancing in chains. For the Greeks, dancing in chains, for poets, for musicians, means not breaking free of limitations of form of tradition, but fitting within those traditions and nonetheless creating. Nietzsche alludes in The Birth of Tragedy to Beethoven's music, the conclusion, as artist and not less theoretically by way of Beethoven's early 19th century Harmonienlehre of dissonance and consonance. And Beethoven's reflections on dissonance are of interest to Nietzsche's own writings on dissonance, but also on harmony, in particular not less on the difference between Greek musical forms and lyric convention. As Beethoven rather didactically explains, keine Dissonanz soll eher resolvieren, als bis der Sinn der Worte völlig geendet ist, wo man sich verweilet, lange Noten, wo man wegeilet, kurze Noten. And I want to stop and explain that. Beethoven's point is that you should not resolve the dissonance until the meaning of the words have already come to a particular end, so that you're going to be using long notes where you're dwelling on a point and where you are moving away from a point, shorter notes. That's the rough translation. We note that Nietzsche emphasized a similar precision at the heart of poetry in a religious, if demystifying, context. In his own writings, rhythm and rhyme are used to influence the deity. If Beethoven's significance cannot be overstated, we may also recall, as Nietzsche did, that, and since Hölderlin Sophocles, the heart of tragedy is joy, das freudigste, freudig zu sagen, the most joyful to say in the most joyful way. And at the end of his first book, Nietzsche could attempt to illustrate what he called the music of the tragic art form, a playing, to use his language, with dissonance, that is, again his language, the thorn of suffering. The key metaphor is musically technical. And with Beethoven, we are on dissonance and consonance, as the musicologists tell us, already underway to what comes to be called the emancipation of dissonance in studies of early 20th century atonal music. We've emphasized that Nietzsche's resolution of the question of tragedy was musical. Birth of Tragedy 22, that's the section, referring to the sound, the music of the very words themselves, that is, to Greek as it was sung. But where our reflections return us to Katie Lang, singing of desire and its indigence and its failures Our love is not a victory march, referring to the paradoxical question that illuminates the problem of pleasure and pain in the ancient Greek tragedy play, speaking of the same phenomenon of musical dissonance, that's Birth of Tragedy 24, where we turn to Katie Lang as she sings, repeating Cohen's hallelujahs and including the gut pain of love and disappointment in oneself, both defiantly and as she crouches into this, drawing her singing out of the depths. Hallelujah in the face of pain. Hence and thus they embody, incarnate Nietzsche's description of the becoming human, that formula appears in the section 25 of The Birth of Tragedy, of dissonance. For MacLean, our musicologist friend, this is the strength, not the weakness of popular music. And this is why, if we follow his argument, so many artists are drawn to cover Cohen's Hallelujah. In another context, I would be keen to emphasize that the language of cover, that's my Adorno hat, is a music industry term, all about copyright and royalties. Here, the point takes us to the heart of the problem of the artist, as Nietzsche poses this problem. Although it should be noted that Nietzsche only raises the question as he does because of his keen concern for what he also called the genius of the heart, that quality, whatever it would take, that would be able to break everything, as Nietzsche says, self-satisfied about us. And we are, if anything, consummate masters at self-satisfaction, even as our world goes, as it were, to hell in a handbasket. Animals, life of all kinds, destroyed at a pace like no other. Human beings along with every other being, and the earth with it. This genius of the heart might expose us when being so exposed is the first condition for reflection, compassion, for what Heidegger called thinking. Here we note the reality of dissonance in tension with the ideality of consonance. And it is for this reason that in his notes, Nietzsche gives us his reflections on pain as productive. And that is to say, and it's here that MacLean's analyses of pain in musical metaphorics can be useful to us, related as counter-color and as generating the beautiful, to use the language of generation as MacLean illustrates it. The indifference, the equanimity in the face of either pleasure or pain, that's an allusion to Schopenhauer in Nietzsche, is also the same that alludes to the dreamer's insight into or through the veil of Maya. It is we ourselves who are the figures in the dream of a god. Figures, as Nietzsche reflects upon Schopenhauer's initially Buddhist point, who have figured out how that god dreams. Beyond Nietzsche's published work on the work of art, on the artist, on consonance, dissonance, especially harmony in The Birth of Tragedy, and including discussions of both tragedy and music in Human All Too Human, one has in the notes, unpublished, numerous discussion of these themes, but in each case it makes all the difference to note the relevance of Nietzsche's inquiry into what he titles in his notes the origin and goal of tragedy. As Nietzsche here explains, what is, this is Nietzsche, the feeling for harmony? On the one side, a subtraction, wegnehmen, of the with sounding, the German is mit klingenden overtones. On the other side, a not individual hearing of the same. To explore what we might call Nietzsche's Harmonienlehre, further here would require a hermeneutic of influence and reference, but at this juncture, in this context, it's worth noting just that in the same locus we read Nietzsche's critical accord with Schopenhauer, invoking nothing less modern than the notion of a false tone. Included together with pain, and we may think of Cohen's cold and broken hallelujah, as we also recall the impossible calm that characterizes Nietzsche's elusive image of a cold angel, just short of the calm that is the extraordinary breath that is the end of Katie Lang's Hallelujah. The question of the artist, the question of the performer, of the dynamic actuality of the singer, invokes the working power of the work of the composer, as it is this that was also for Nietzsche the very political question of musical culture. There is for the Greek no term, no word for art. Closest they come is techne. There is for the Greek no cult of the artist, but rather a contest between artists in a democratic culture of contests that involved the entire polis. And this is not a popularity contest, so it is nothing like American Idol. It's a language where everyone is involved, everyone is included. It's thus that I understand Nietzsche's musing. Es muss viele Übermenschen geben. There have to be a lot of overhumans, of overhuman beings. For, and as Aristotle himself also emphasized, good things can only develop among like and similarly good things, people too. But this makes the exception problematic. Thus Nietzsche struggled from start to finish with the question of whether the artist, the genius, the maestro, was to be valorized as we do indeed valorize the artist. The problem of the artist is thus related to the problem of the scientist, which Nietzsche himself would also go on to differentiate in more colorful terms as gay versus gray, that is, as plodding researcher versus argonaut of the spirit. Thus Nietzsche's The Birth of Tragedy distinguishes between what he calls the spirit of science, he mentions that in Birth of Tragedy 17, and you can also find that in Human All Too Human in several sections, and the spirit of music in the same text, out of which he traces the genesis of the tragic work of art. And arguably, it is the cult of the artist, the cult of the star, that's also to say the music, the culture industry, that similarly blocks our path today. Here we return to Katie Lang. For Nietzsche, the scientist is an artist, tout court, but one who not only fails to know this about him or herself, but who also denies it, dissembling this artistry whenever an inkling of this truth comes to light, be it for him or herself, but above all for society, inasmuch as here too it's a matter of prestige, one finds as everywhere will to power. And it is science today, and it had better have the truth, not the artistry, rather than religion, that is the very best means for the advancement of both our slavish capacities and our slavish morality, where there is, for Nietzsche, and of course, no other kind. And obviously the slave has the most interest in mastery, more than the master has. The master has no interest in mastery because, remember Hegel, he is master. Katie Lang, so I have argued above, would seem to know all this and more about the artist. And thus Nietzsche privileges the artist above the scientist, but and only for the sake of life. As Katie Lang sings what Cohen would say, hallelujah. Thank you for your attention.